We're continuing a series called Grow. This is the fourth one. There will be one more next week talking about ways we need to grow. As an example, the Bible says Jesus grew in wisdom. How many of you believe that if Jesus grew in wisdom, you might need to grow in wisdom too? Probably so. He grew in stature. Well, that's kind of an automatic for most of us. We grow taller as we grow older. We grow wider as we grow older, however it happens to hit you. He grew physically. He grew in favor with God, and he grew in favor with the people. So he grew in a lot of different ways, and there are different ways we need to grow. One of the ways we want to grow in wisdom is by looking at Proverbs. This is the fourth week, so I'm looking at Proverbs chapter 4 next week. Can anybody guess which proverb we'll look at? 5, because it'll be the fifth Sunday of the year. Then after that, it'll be 6, because that'll be the sixth Sunday. So we're going through chapter, a verse or two out of each one, each of the first 31 weeks, and then we'll just kind of go back and pick out some gems along the way. Proverbs 4:18-19 says, "The way of the righteous is like the first gleam of dawn, which shines ever brighter until the full light of day. But the way of the wicked is like total darkness. They have no idea what they are stumbling over." Now, the entire chapter talks about the value of seeking after wisdom and the importance of pursuing it. That tells me that wisdom's not automatic. Growing older doesn't automatically mean you grow wiser. It requires intentional effort. But when you grow wiser, what happens is that you continue to grow and you continue to advance in your understanding and your insight of the world with the full light of understanding that comes through a life that is committed and submitted to Jesus Christ. The four things we've looked at so far is growing closer to God is the first goal we talked about back the first Sunday of the year. And we do that through our devotion to Him, through our dedication to Him, through our desire to follow after Him. A couple of weeks ago, we looked at the fact that we grow more helpful to others through our service. And Jesus made it very clear that if you want to be great in the kingdom of God, you've got to become the servant of all. And that serving is the key of being a follower of Christ. Last week, we had our good friend here with us, Josh Wellborn, who I've known all of his life, for real. That's kind of not many people you can say that about. But he talked about the fact that we have to grow wiser in wisdom by taking on an attitude of humility. We can't get wiser if we are arrogant. Why is that? Because we already know everything. Humility helps us to gain wisdom. Today I want to talk about we grow more influential through a life of integrity. Now, influence is it's an interesting word for our culture today, a word that many of you are familiar with. Some of you maybe not, but probably all are aware of it one way or the other. It's the word influencer. I know you guys know what an influencer is over on this side, but an influencer is someone who uses, in our culture today, primarily their social network to create a favorable response for something. And if you get a large influencer that likes what you're doing, there's going to be hundreds, if not thousands, that follow. There's a commercial on right now. I was watching football yesterday, surprise, surprise. And the commercial is about this lady. I don't remember all the specific details, but it's about this lady, and she makes pans. And I think, if I remember the word right, or I think either her name or the title of her company or something, but it's Titan, T-I-T-A-N, Titan, like a giant. I think it's even her name. Maybe she's, I don't know, maybe Asian or something, and her name's Titan. Or the way it comes out, it's called Titan's Pans is her website. But one of the players in this little made-up story they concoct on here, one of the players for the Tennessee Titans responds to her website thinking that he's responding to Titans fans. And if you've seen the little commercial, it says that as he responds to her website and everyone sees who he is and he says some good things, all of a sudden she sells out of product. And before long, she's having to sell stock now, and her company's growing so large because one person who was an influencer liked what she had. Here's what influence, how it is described by the dictionary. It says it's the capacity to have an effect on the character, development, or behavior of someone or something, or the effect itself. Now, I'm giving you four things. Next week, I'm going to talk about growing in your fellowship, your connection with other people. Maybe God will give you a sixth or seventh or eighth area that you need to grow in. Maybe you'll be the grand prize winner and get 21 ways that he wants you to grow. But I think it would be good if we recognize the need to grow in influence. And I'm going to say a couple things today that'll seem contrary probably and maybe startling a little bit even. And that's a good thing. So hang with me. Jesus alludes to the fact that we are to influence our world in the Sermon on the Mount. Right after the start, he talks about the different ways that we are blessed, and all of them have a negative connotation to them. We would say in our natural, well, the blessed life, by the way, that's kind of a hashtag for some people, right? The blessed life is when I have a new car, a nice house, a great job. That's the blessed life. But Jesus said the blessed life is when you mourn, when you're poor, when you're persecuted. How many of you believe his words are a little bit startling to the ears of our world today? Jesus said after that, he didn't say you should be or you might be. He simply made this statement of definition: you are the salt of the earth. Now, one of the tendencies that people like me have, we preacher people, we tend to find something and we try to figure out our own spin on the thing. And one thing I'm committed to as much as I can is to make sure I'm not trying to spin it into what I think it needs to say and really trying to get back to what the original thought was. I think there are some things we can discern from this and things that we can say, but I just want to be careful not to go too far with it and make up all kind of storylines that I think if Jesus had intended to make all the storylines that are out there, he probably would have said some of them instead of leaving it up for us to guess. But he says you're salt. What does salt mean? Well, just a real basic level of salt is this. Salt is not easily seen, but it is quickly tasted. It seems somewhat insignificant. That word will come up again in a minute. It seems rather ordinary or common. As a matter of fact, some people call it common table salt. Anybody ever do something in your life that you're not really proud you did, but you know, occasionally have to acknowledge those things? Can I just see some hands of affirmation to let me share a quick story here that wasn't entirely my doing, that was very little of my doing, but I did laugh. Several years ago, not here, another church, I was out with the staff. We were having lunch, and one guy got up and he left the table. And this guy was kind of, for whatever reason that day, had gotten on the nerves of the other people a little bit and was kind of whiny and kind of complaining, kind of griping and whatever. And how many of you know that when you do that, you're painting a bullseye like on your chest? Not right or wrong, just a fact. So when he went to the restroom, one of the other guys in the team, not me, I'm serious, I'm not trying it. If I did it, I would tell you it wasn't me. One of the other guys got the salt shaker, took the lid off, and poured about this much of it in his drink and then stirred it all up. You couldn't see it, couldn't even smell it, but he sure did taste it when he took that first drink. It was not a very pleasant response. A new drink was ordered quickly. I think it was Coke or Diet Coke. I'm not sure which one he was having, but we got a fresh one and a new one there. And here's what I know, that the salt made a difference in what was going on. Jesus said, not only are you salt, he says, you're also light. And here's what light does. Light doesn't, it's not something you can touch. It's not something you can taste. But wow, does it have impact. When it's missing, can you imagine how long it would take you to get from here, I'll just say to Oklahoma City, in a pitch black night, even if you were in your car? You would toil all night, and you would do the best you could to try to stay on the road, and when the sun came up, you would be about 100 feet from your house. Because you can't drive in the dark, at least not for very long, because you'll hit a tree or a post or wind up in the ditch. Now, what's Jesus saying? He's saying we need to have an impact on our world. We need to have influence in our world. When you look at the book of Acts, which we're going to do today in a very quick manner, and I'm going to talk about parts of it, mainly the first part, but I'm going to throw one at the back part in just to show I could have done 28 chapters and done all of them here. The church in the book of Acts had a massive influence on its world immediately and perpetually. It wasn't like a one-time splash. The church of the book of Acts turned the world on its ear. They caused the world to make all kinds of decisions and plans and strategies and have special meetings. The church in the book of Acts was a church of incredible influence. Think about opening day, the day they opened for business. And they had had a soft launch before, about 3 years, I guess, of a soft launch, but here it was, grand opening day, day of Pentecost. There's a group gathered, 120 people. The Holy Spirit comes down, and on that day, 3,000 people were added to their numbers on opening day. You go to the next chapter, and a lame man gets up and walks. That's a pretty incredible thing to have happen. You go later on, and 5,000 more are added to the church. Oh, and by the way, the leaders get arrested. You go on down the book, and all of a sudden we see that signs and wonders occur. Not all of them of a joyful nature. Acts chapter 5, a couple of the religious people, part of the inner circle, decide they're going to sell property and they're going to give it but keep some back for themselves, but say they gave it all, which the problem there is being dishonest with the Holy Spirit, and they die and are carried out of church. Now, that's never been in any book I've ever read about how to grow your church. But the power of God in demonstration brings results. Later on, we read just after that, that people would be healed and miracles would occur, signs and wonders would happen. And then we see after that, one of my favorite storylines here is that many Jewish priests were converted. I'll come back to that in a little more detail in just a moment. Now here's the word I'm going to give you that's going to, like, you're going to go say, what? Time out? I don't understand. You know why the early church was influential, why they had influence? Because they weren't trying to be influential. One of the tragedies that happens in life is we try to figure out how to get the results we want and what's the shortcut and how to get there instead of becoming the people that we need to be. So we're trying to be the headliner. We're trying to make a splash. We're trying to see what we can do. And some of that is okay. It's not, we need to understand culture and society and do our best to impact it. But let's make sure that when we do, it's not with the wisdom of man, but it's with the power of God. Churches get so just goofed up on this. And we take whatever side we take and we hold on to that and we grab hold of that and think that's the way to go. And one that's amazing to me still going on today is when people talk about what kind of clothes they wear to their church. And I've heard literally church leaders have these great discussions about what they wanted to be known for was a church where they had casual dress. And if you're going, what's wrong with casual dress? Nothing. But here's what it is, though. That's like a restaurant wanting to be known for having pretty napkins. Seriously? You're a restaurant. You want to be known for the color of your tablecloth? What should a restaurant be known for? Food. What should a church be known for? The fact that Jesus Christ shows up in the lives of individuals, not just on Sunday morning, but all week long, and we live in his power as we walk through life. It's amazing. It's startling. There's an old joke that goes about a guy that came to this church, and he walks in. He's kind of a hippie guy. It's probably a story came back in the 80s or 90s, I guess, first time I heard it. And he comes in, and he sits down, and some of the leaders in the church go up and say, hey, you know, we're glad you're here and everything, but, you know, you got on blue jeans and a T-shirt, and you don't even have shoes on, and, you know, this is the house of God, and you dress better. And he came back the next week, and he had on a different T-shirt. He thought that was better. And they're like, no, you need. And he said, well, what I need. He said, then you need to pray to Jesus and ask him what he would wear if he came to church here. And he came back the next week, and he had on a pair of jeans and different T-shirt and some sandals this time. And they said, I thought we asked you to pray to Jesus and ask him what he would wear if he came to this church. And he said, well, I did. And they said, well, what did Jesus say? Jesus said he's never been invited here before. So, now where most people go when they hear a joke like that is they either take the side of the hippie or they take the side of the church people. And they either get defensive or they justify or whatever. When, how many of you know that's not the issue? I'm wearing a jacket today just because I haven't worn one in a while and I felt like putting it on. Doesn't matter. There's always, I think, a place for appropriateness. Appropriateness probably varies point to point. It's not nearly as ironclad as we think always. But more than what you're wearing on the outside, and here's the kingdom of God, what God's more concerned about is what's on the inside. The early church wasn't concerned about trying to be influential. They were just trying to get it right. They were walking with God, walking in the Spirit. They were walking in what I call integrity. Integrity is a word that means wholeness. It's the word integer that means a whole number. It means to be a complete person. That's why they could heal someone no matter what day it was. That's why they could do it when they were over here or over there. There wasn't come to our magic spot with the right people and the right formula. Let us get everything concocted perfectly and we can do something for you. It was because of the power of Jesus Christ, the power of the Holy Spirit that resides in the life of his followers. Be filled with the power of God. Live in that awareness. The way of the kingdom of God is contrary to human logic. Jesus says if you want to be great, you've got to become a servant. The way to leadership is not by lording it over others, but it's by caring for others. It is by not trying to place yourself at the front by taking the last spot. came across this many years ago now, probably 30 years ago. A guy named Richard Dobbins put some of this together, and I've kind of updated it through the years. It's called The Upside Paradigm of the Kingdom of God, and it's a whole teaching within itself that I won't get into right now, but here's the contrast. Our human nature focuses on the physical, whereas the Christian focus is on the spiritual. Human nature is on the temporal. Christian focuses on the eternal. Paul talks about that in Corinthians. Again, the seen and the unseen, the outward versus the inward, competition versus cooperation. You know, you can determine rather quickly the spiritual maturity of a church by how they view other churches near them. It's an amazing kind of thought that often churches will send thousands of dollars to help missionaries in other parts of the world, hundreds of dollars to a church that's in another part of the state, but often they will be rather chagrined when a new church starts in their community. God, build your kingdom. Bring people into your kingdom and use every resource within your power to make it happen. Make us to be effective. But bless every church in Owosso, Collinsville, Tulsa, Bixby, Broken Arrow, Claremore. Forgive me for not naming all the cities in the area, but bless every one of them, God, that proclaims Jesus Christ as Lord, that stands in the power of the Holy Spirit, that stands on the Word of God. Give them power to be effective in bringing people into your kingdom, and may we rejoice that the kingdom of God advances, because they are not our competition. We are in cooperation with them against the works of the enemy to advance the kingdom of light. Amen. Winning versus losing. It's been said winning is everything, but Jesus said, you want to save your life? Then lose it. Wait, what? You want to be influential? Then don't try to be influential. See, we get in the way when we try too hard sometimes. We get out of the way, and God does some pretty incredible things. One of my favorite definitions I've ever heard of what it means to see the supernatural, to walk in the supernatural, one guy said it like this. He said, well, it's a combination between you and God. As long as you know your role, it's going to work. Here's how it goes. You let God be super and you be natural. When you try to be super, it's not going to work. When you just walk in who you are, that's when God can show up. Let me get through this. You see the other things there? Let me skip past that. Let me get down to the first point. You can read some other stuff later. That's why you get all the notes. You can read it later. Two guardrails that kept the church on track. Number one guardrail is this. The message of the early church was Jesus the Lord. It's a foundational principle of the kingdom of God, and it's proven by obedience. I'm going to go through some of the stories I mentioned quickly a while ago. When they received the Spirit empowerment, the disciples preached Jesus as Lord and Messiah. Here's what Peter said in Acts 2:36. So let everyone in Israel know for certain that God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, to be both Lord and Messiah. He was very clear, words that would penetrate the heart of Jewish people. He's saying Jesus is not just a good man, a good teacher. He's not someone who had a good idea. He is the Lord. That is the word used for God. He is the one who rules over all. And he is Messiah, the one sent by God to bring salvation. When they encountered the lame man, they declared in the name of Jesus, get up and walk. They didn't have to take a long time to come up with a plan or a solution or some strategy. They simply said in the name of Jesus, get up and walk. The prompting of the Holy Spirit. The influence of Jesus was evident in the disciples as they refused to stop speaking about what they had seen and heard. I was thinking about this, earlier in the week looking at this. And I think maybe some problem for some believers, we just haven't seen and heard enough lately. So we don't have a whole lot to talk about. Can I pray this prayer for you and for me with absolute sincerity? God, give each one of us a fresh vision of who you are and what you've done. Give us ears to hear a fresh word from you that causes us to want to talk about what you have done for us. Why did this early church make such an impact, such an influence on their world? Well, let me take out a couple of thoughts that some people might have. Well, it's because they were some extraordinary people. After all, this was the 12, now 11, apostles. Got to scratch Judas Iscariot off the list. I know they got a new one, but we'll stick with 11 for now. Here's what it says about them in chapter 4, verse 13. The members of the council were amazed when they saw the boldness of Peter and John, for they could see that they were ordinary men. God, give us more ordinary men and women who will depend upon you and have boldness because of your power that is in them. Listen to this, it gets better. Ordinary men with no special training. Well, God, I'll do more for you once I become better trained and once I've had all the things I need to know, once I learn all those things. How many of you have discovered that when you try to learn everything you need to know, you realize you're never going to get there? Now, there's a book written several years ago by one of our former heroes of the faith in the Assemblies of God, a man named C.M. Ward. He was a Canadian, and I had the privilege of knowing him and actually taking him to a hockey game, which is a whole other experience, in St. Louis one time when he came to speak for our church, and taking him out to dinner. And he was known for his wit, for his candor. He was just an incredible man. I've still got many of his publications and writings. And Brother Lambert, I know you were good friends with him, and you have a lot of his information too. And he wrote a book a few years ago. It was simply called this, Things They Never Taught Me in Bible College. Yeah, you're not a preacher, but you can put things they never taught you wherever you went to school at. How many of you know when you graduate from university, when you graduate even with advanced degrees, and you think, okay, now I am the expert? You know what I've discovered? Knowledge teaches me how much I don't know and how much more there is out there. These were ordinary men with no special training. I'm not against training. I'm not against people who are talented and gifted, but they had something more. Here's what it says next. They recognized them as men who had been with Jesus. There's something about the relationship with Jesus, intimacy with Jesus, what we talked about the first week, that gives you the power to be a person of influence, because you're not trying to be a person of influence. You're just trying to be close to Jesus and obey what he tells you to do. Miracles were happening through the hands of the apostles. Acts 5, 12 through 16 talks about that. I love this verse here. The next point, many of the Jewish priests placed their faith in the Lordship of Jesus and became obedient. You know what the proof of the Lordship of Jesus is for your life? It's obedience to his word. One of the most disturbing comments by Jesus in the New Testament that just kind of just stuns you is when he makes this announcement He says, why do you call me Lord when you don't do the things I tell you to do? And they said, oh, but Lord, we cast out demons and we healed the sick. He went, whoa, why you call me Lord? Well, because we didn't. No. You didn't obey. See, obedience is proof of the lordship of Jesus Christ. Many of the Jewish priests were converted because of the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Acts 9:31, I thought about this verse. I knew it was already in my notes, but when Kevin was praying a while ago, the church then had peace throughout Judea, Galilee, and Samaria, and it became stronger as the believers lived in the fear of the Lord, and with the encouragement of the Holy Spirit, it also grew in numbers. Now, here's what I know about life. Because there is an enemy who is warring against us, peace will not be complete until we are removed from this planet. But I'm praying that in the midst of strife and difficulty, even as Pastor Kevin prayed earlier, I echo that prayer. God, in the midst of difficulty, in the midst of uncertainty, let the peace that is bigger than any of our comprehension or understanding guard our heart and mind as we draw near to you. It's interesting to note, Acts 1:8, you all know that verse, right? You will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the uttermost parts of the earth. Now here we are in chapter 9, just not too long later. The church then had peace throughout. Jerusalem's not mentioned because there's a little bit of stuff going on there, but Judea, Galilee, and Samaria. What was prophesied in Acts 1:8 is being played out in 9:31. And you'll see it more in the latter part of the book. This isn't the fulfillment, but this is the glimpse of what is yet to come. The early church had the guardrail of the message of Jesus being Lord, which is the foundational principle of the kingdom of God. Here's what you have to understand. The kingdom of God is not about the temporal things of this world. It's about the eternal things. The second guardrail they had with this was the power of the early church was the baptism of the Holy Spirit. The baptism of the Holy Spirit is mentioned 5 times in the book of Acts. You can look at that later and read through it. But what you find out is because of the Holy Spirit, the early church had power. They were empowered by the Holy Spirit. It's amazing how we take power for granted. Has anybody ever walked over to the light switch, flipped it on, and nothing happened? We are so programmed, we have so much faith in that power source that most of us will do this exact thing that I'm going to say right now as soon as that happens. We'll flip the switch on and it doesn't come on and we'll go, well, that can't be right. We'll flip it off and back on again as if somehow power will now be restored to that light bulb. The problem typically is the light bulb is no longer usable. It's not the power source, but sometimes you ever have the power go off at your house? Isn't it amazing? And I don't know what you've done or haven't done, but I'm just being real honest with you right now. I mean, power going on off in our house happens incredibly rare. Anybody ever travel around the world where power goes off like for 5 hours every day? You know, or you're not sure when you're going to have it. You'll have power sometime between. It's kind of like when they tell us the serviceman will show up somewhere between 2 and 5. And they go, oh, 2 in the morning and 5 in the afternoon. Yeah, that's what they mean. But 2 and 5. Some countries, that's how you get electricity. You'll have it somewhere between 2 and 5. Maybe tomorrow. If we, as a church and as individuals, are not experiencing the Holy Spirit working in our lives, we are forfeiting the power to be people of influence. They were empowered by the Holy Spirit. They were led by the Holy Spirit. It's amazing what they would do when they were facing serious decisions. They would stop and they would pray. They would use phrases like this: it seemed good to the Holy Spirit and to us. Jesus tells us that he would send the Holy Spirit who would guide us into all truth. Paul says this in Romans chapter 8, for as many as are led by the Spirit, they are the children of God. They are the sons of God. Now, here is what I can draw from that, and I don't think I'm stretching words too far. If that is true, then the opposite would also be true. For as many as are not led by the Spirit, they are not the children of God. You cannot walk in the flesh. And by the way, flesh simply means human effort. You can't accomplish in human effort what starts in the Spirit. That's the book of Galatians, by the way. How did you start so well but end up so poorly? It's because you started in the Spirit, but now you're trying to finish it in the flesh. Now, there is a place of cooperation where God anoints and uses us. But let us never lean on our understanding. Never let us lean on our ability, but let us hear from God fresh. Let us receive from him empowerment for the day. I think that it's a temptation for a lot of Christians to look at being a Christian as putting a checklist together, and you do all your little good things and you get check marks or gold stars or however you want to mark it, and that's a good day. But it's not a matter of, did you say your prayer this morning? Yes, you should pray every morning. But there's more to it than that. What if you approach the relationship with your spouse that way? Like a checklist. I have a feeling you would have a lot to talk through. And you'd probably need somebody to help you. They were led by the Spirit. They walked in the Spirit. Without going into a lot of detail, let me give you a couple thoughts here about the Holy Spirit, his work in your life. The baptism of the Holy Spirit is an intentional daily yielding of yourself to the control of the Holy Spirit. It is more than an event, it's a lifestyle. Now, in the book of Acts, 5 times it talks about baptism in the Holy Spirit. 3 of the times the phrase is used about speaking in tongues. By the way, if you're looking for proof text, which proof text means a text that proves your theory, it's not the best way to read the Bible. But there are times where there's some benefit to understanding what text represents whatever. And the fact that 3 times this is mentioned in the book of Acts is it actually, in the way the book is written, is a very large number. When you go back and see it also being talked about by Paul to the church at Corinth, not directly but alluded to by Jude, he talks about praying in the Spirit. It becomes very evident it was something when it's talked about with such clarity as Acts chapter 2, then it's my clear, deep conviction that speaking in tongues is part of being baptized in the Spirit. And the way that the Assemblies of God states it is this: it is the initial physical evidence of the baptism. You should desire it. You should want it. It blesses your life. It indicates control of even your voice to God. How many of you know that James says the hardest thing to control on any person is the tongue? So we say, God, take control of my life. But it's not something that happens one time and I'm done. It's not like I got my my book stamped and I'm good now. It is a continual process of daily living in the presence of God, growing in that experience. And here's what it does for you. Three things. There are points 5, 6, and 7 on the second point. The baptism of the Holy Spirit produces godly qualities in your life, also known as the fruit of the Spirit. The baptism of the Holy Spirit will lead you in a path of integrity, because the Holy Spirit always leads you right, not wrong. He'll take you to the right place. I don't mean to make light. I'm not making fun. I think there's a place for us using our mind and our thought process to the best of our ability. But I think sometimes today, people in our culture, church culture, gets so worked up on what we have to do to make it work, and what's our branding, and how do we do that, and this, and whatever, and that. I just don't like to see Peter getting up on the day of Pentecost going, "You think the blue tie looks better?" I don't see him doing anything like that. It's just a matter of he was ready, and when opportunity showed up, God anointed it, and something supernatural occurred. Oh, God, don't let us be satisfied with the material, with what we can produce, but God, help us to long for what only you can do. God, change our world by first of all changing us. I may be wrong. This is my speculation on this event. I think I'm right, though, as I think about it. You'll see where I'm going here. This was a little bit off the cuff, so you can kind of pick that up. When the 120 were in the upper room, I don't see like 70 of them sitting over in the corner, looking at the other 50 going, "Y'all go. Come on, Pete, you the man." I don't see that. You know what I read? And they were all baptized. They're all ordinary people. This isn't about something that's for one or two or for. It's not even about some theatrical thing happening. It's about you having a personal encounter with God that absolutely shapes your world. A different path, a different plane. And whatever boat we're in, we get so caught up on it needs to happen this way, that way. Do this, do that, say this, go there. I just want to say, God, show up and fill hungry hearts. And let it be not just for the moment, but let it be for tomorrow and Tuesday. And when you're going through the drive-through on Wednesday for lunch because you're in a real hurry and you don't even have time and you're going to eat in your car, I don't know what you're going to say or how it's going to work out, but it might be that as you're going through that drive-through, God's going to give an opportunity for you to say a quick word in the right season to the person that's giving you your food, and it may change their life forever. By the way, I don't know if it's Wednesday or Thursday, it's going to happen. Not trying to be funny, I'm just trying to tell you, you never know, so you always have to be ready. You got to stay full. Can I tell you this? I'm going to wrap up really quick here, but let me tell you this. If your Christian life is just a boring, mundane experience, why not trade it in for something today? Why not say, I'd rather have something with a little more to it? And again, the formula is simple. You be natural and let God be super. The more the Holy Spirit saturates your life, the more you'll be positioned to be a person of influence. Well, I only got you up to chapter 9 of Acts, so let me skip over to 17 and throw the last part of this verse out. I wish I could talk about it more. I'll do it later some other time. But here's what the townspeople are saying before the city officials. They're talking about the apostles. They're talking about the people of God who've come to their town. And here's what they say. These men who have turned the world upside down have now come here. How many of you believe our world right now, today, could use being turned upside down? Because it's the wrong way already. Let's flip it back over right. I know we can't fix the world, but all I want to do is just keep bringing people to Jesus as much as I can. And rather than thinking, boy, I wish our church would do this or our church would do that, can I just impart to you this closing thought? You are the church. Filled with the power of God, proclaiming the Lordship of Jesus. May you go in His power and in His strength, and may you influence your neighbors, your coworkers, your family, your friends, your colleagues, the lady that's serving you food out the window at the drive-thru. May you have an impact on them that changes their life and moves them toward the kingdom. And may there even be some Jewish priest who are converted and begin to obey. Would you bow your heads? If you're watching online, I encourage you to make this a moment of personal inspection in your life with the aid of the Holy Spirit. First of all, if you're not where you need to be today in your walk with God, the Bible has a solution. It's called repentance. It means to turn away from your sin and turn toward God, to begin to pursue Him. Today, if you need that in your life, I'm going to pray with you. And as you pray in your own heart, I believe that the power of the Holy Spirit is strong enough to bring lasting change to your life. If you're here in the room, you'd say, Pastor, I need that today. Very fast, would you raise your hand as high as you can just so I can see and pray for you right now? Thank you. Anywhere else across the room? Thank you. I'm going to pray this prayer. Would you just pray with me in your heart right now? God, I thank you that you have given me the opportunity to be your child. Through the work of Jesus Christ on the cross, His shed blood provided forgiveness for my sins. And through faith in Him, I am made a new creation. Old things pass away, all things become new. Lord, I pray that you would help me to be a person of integrity, a person of humility. Lord, for it's only when I am weak that you can be strong. May we never boast in our abilities. May we never take comfort from what we can do. But may we always long for what you will do when we yield our lives to you. Holy Spirit, I thank you that you are the resource that we experience now, the divine personage of the Trinity that guides us, that dwells in us, that leads us in the right path, that makes us productive. Holy Spirit, may we be filled with your presence. May you saturate our words, our thoughts, our motives. May we decrease continually, and may the kingdom of God be advanced. Lord, I thank you that your love is beyond measure. How marvelous. How amazing is your grace. Now may we open our hearts and let you fill us with you. Thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to ask a question that's kind of a backwards thought, probably. One of my friends wrote me a note this morning, one of my past friends. He said, I'm praying for you today that you'll have boldness and clarity and thought. And I knew what I was going to preach about today, and I thought, man, if I ever needed clarity, it's today. And I hope that somehow the Holy Spirit helped me to get out what was in my heart that I think was from Him. I don't mean it with any sense of arrogance, any sense of pride in self. I mean it as a person who is submitted to the Lordship of Jesus Christ. And that's how I'm asking you to respond right now. But how many of you will join me and you'll say, with God's help and for God's glory, I want to grow in my influence in my world? And I know that's kind of a tricky thing, because I told you a while ago they grew in influence because they weren't trying to grow in influence. It's not that I'm trying to grow in influence for me, and I'm not wanting to write a book or tell a story. I'm just wanting God to use my life so that His kingdom is advanced and made stronger. If that connects with you and you would just join me and say, man, there's nothing about me in this statement at all, but it's all about God and His glory. It's my desire to be saturated with the Holy Spirit. I want God to use me to be a person of influence for His kingdom. If that's you, would you just stand all across the room? How many, if it's two or three or six, I don't know, if whatever it is. If you don't stand up, no judgments at all, because it's kind of a weird ask even. I don't even know. But I pray the Holy Spirit will do a work. One of the signs that we have, and I think biblically it's there, it's a symbol of humility. It's a symbol of dependence, is lifting up hands. It's a symbol of acknowledging a greater source. Across the room, would you just lift up your hand right now, or your hands to God, and say, Lord, do this in my life. Holy Spirit, baptize me. Take control of my life, my heart, my words. Help me to be more like you. So open up your heart right now and ask God to fill you. He delights in doing that. We thank you, Lord. Holy Spirit, work. God, I pray for lasting change. A change that will make a difference throughout the week. A daily journey depending on you completely.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. I think it's very evident the Lord's trying to tell us He is near to us. He is with us. Will you receive all that He has for you? Lift your heart to Him right now and say, Lord, give me all that You have for me. Maybe you're like at a spot where you're just kind of barely getting into the water. Then just get into your level. Maybe you're in water deep enough to swim. We'll jump in. But keep moving out into what God has for you. Keep moving into the presence of God. Father, I thank You that the church is not only the group that meet for an hour on Sunday morning, but individually we make up the church. We have responsibility, we have opportunity that can only be accomplished through supernatural power. May we grow in influence in our world as You empower us. May we cast off all of the distractions of the world. May we push away every hindrance and every weight that would beset us. And may we pursue You, running after You with determination, perseverance. Lord, I pray for me right now that You would fill me with more of Your presence. Continue to work in my life that I may have godly influence on everyone I encounter. Let it be done in the heart and the life of everyone here today, for everyone watching online. As we desire that, may it be done. Thank You, Lord, for the word that we heard in prayer earlier today, that when we ask, You will answer. When we seek, we will find. When we knock, the door will be open. God, we pray for You to accomplish Your will in us. In Jesus' name, amen. Now here's what I want you to do. I want you to take about 30 seconds to a minute right now, and I want you to pray your own prayer to God right now and say, Lord, I'm available. Lord, use me. However you want to say it, whatever He's talking to you about right now, would you right now have that personal encounter with God? It says, Lord, I'm all in, and I want You to use me right now. 30 seconds to a minute. Just pray it out all across the room. Thank You, Jesus.